Whether a German, a Dutchman, or an outsider, West Germany versus Holland in the European Championship semi-final was a big game indeed. There was no question about that. Nobody wanted to make a mistake in a match of this magnitude. Managers and goalkeepers remained alert, relieving their nervous energies and keeping their concentration the way men of football do. Defenders cleared their lines at all costs, petrified that they might be responsible for a damaging error, or even worse, being caught in possession, the mortal sin of defending. So it was of little surprise that, after 45 minutes of high anxiety, the game should remain goalless. In the second half, the forwards began to emerge into the pattern of the game, particularly Jürgen Klinsmann, who was never a man to duck a penalty area opportunity. The referee agreed with Klinsmann. The Dutch did not. When a player is running towards you in the penalty area, you are not considering whether his name is Jürgen Klinsmann or if he has a different name. So it was not the case that I expected something in particular from Jürgen Klinsmann. I didn't consider whether he was going to fall over or not. But I must say at the time, in my view, it was not a real offence. But later, when I saw it on television, I thought it seemed like a penalty. Klinsmann simply handled it in a very clever and scheming way. He saw my leg move forwards and, of course, he let himself fall over it big time. And I think that is professional. He did it very well. Looking back at it on television, I thought, yes, it is a penalty. Finished. With the Germans determined to hold on to their game and the disenchanted Dutch resolved to draw level, old enmities began to resurface.
Oh yes, there is a very special rivalry between the Dutch and the Germans. However, I personally think this applies more to the Dutch. In general, in sport, the Dutch are fanatically against the Germans. This also applied to our team. There were a couple of players in our team who were really fanatical about beating Germany. I personally don't have this. I see Germany just as any other competitor. I mean, I respect German and English competitors. For me, it is all the same. But with a lot of players, the sentiments of war play a role. This applies to the whole Dutch nation.
When Marco van Basten controlled the ball and glided into the German penalty area, he heard the whistle and knew the referee had balanced the account. The German goalkeeper and the linesman discussed the matter, but they both understood.
As
a professional, you actually don't expect anything, but you try to get it. You play to balance the score. You play simply to win a match. We were fortunate that the referee awarded us quite an easy penalty. This probably had to do with the fact that he also decided in favor of Germany. So I think he intended to balance it that way. But as a player, you have no influence. As a player, you can only do your best and give 100%.
With the seconds ticking down and extra time looming, Van Basten received a pass in his favored position and slid home the winner. The Dutch had not conquered Germany in a full international for 32 years. Now they had, in a European Championship semi-final and on German soil. Yet Michels was determined that they should not and would not treat this victory as their finale. The USSR had defeated Italy in the other semi-final. The Dutch had lost to the Soviets in their opening match. Hulit, Rijkaard and the team still had a championship final to face.
I've known Ruud since my childhood. I've played a lot with him in the street, played a lot of football in the street. It was very enjoyable in those days. We had a nice neighborhood with a lot of good players. We were, in fact, the only two that made an international breakthrough. Yes, there was a lot of joy after the match. I personally was very happy as well. I was particularly happy because we had beaten Germany in Germany itself. And Germany has a reputation of being a very good competitor. So I thought it was a major achievement, and, as I indicated before, there were also a lot of players who were extremely happy because they thought, now we have finally had revenge for 1974. But okay, I think you should keep these things separately. Every match stands on its own. But there was an enormous amount of joy in the dressing room, yes.
De Russen worden altijd onderschat.
The Russians have always been underestimated on an international level. They are not entirely taken seriously. If there has ever been a competition in which the Russians showed excellent football from a defensive point of view, that it has been in 1988.
That the Dutch had managed to fail in all the other previous finals which they had contested was uppermost in the minds of most neutral observers, and uppermost in the minds of most Dutchmen, one suspects. On the 25th of July 1988, Holland met the USSR in front of 72,000 spectators in the Olympic Stadium Munich, and millions more tuned into television sets across Europe. The Soviets had defeated the Dutch 1-0 just 13 days earlier, and they started the final confident of continuing where they had left off. Mikkel's assessment of Soviet football appeared well-founded as the men from the East strived to wrestle the initiative from the Dutch. A sound and capable defense was backed up by a free-flowing forward line which moved the ball cleverly through the attacking channels, probing for an opening and never goal-shy when an opportunity presented itself. Then, after 25 all-action minutes, Ruud Gullit began to take control for Holland, like a wild stallion leading his herd to safety. That Gullit was a master footballer would, on this evidence, never be in doubt. Late into the first half, a Dutch corner was purposefully nodded down by Gullit. As the Soviets streamed out, a cross was immediately returned into their penalty area, and Ruud Gullit dispatched a header the way other men dispatch a volley. Holland were now ahead. The Soviets resumed their attacking style in the second half. Internally, the USSR was starting to look westward. Soviet players were now harboring ambitions for a career outside their homeland. If the Dutch faithful believed a single Ruud Gullit goal would demoralize this Soviet team, they were very much mistaken. A European Championship final was the finest shop window any player wanting to attract attention to his skills could hope for. Then, in the 53rd minute of a pulsating match, Van Basten connected with a strike of supreme confidence, unparalleled technique, and breathtaking accuracy. The game was over for the Soviet Union. There was no way back from this level of expertise. The Dutch had at last proved to themselves and to the world at large that they could come into a final, absorb pressure, shake themselves free, and finish strong and victorious.
Well, of course, you experience every top achievement in your career as the best kind of experience. When you talk about these things, you are looking back. There is a difference between them. The 1988 reception in Amsterdam and in Eindhoven dominates one's memories when looking back on it. The reaction of the whole nation, not only the football fanatics, not only because we won the championship, but especially because of the defeat of Germany.
Van Duitsland.
Relief and pleasure showed upon the faces of every Dutch player as he touched the Delaney Cup. Although a loser, every Russian player knew that he had done his reputation a power of good. The Dutch then unashamedly unraveled their flag and ran with it around the perimeter of the Munich Stadium.
One of the high spots, absolutely. I mean, winning something with the national team was a huge feast. We had a terrific reception afterwards when we came back to the Netherlands. Indeed, it has been one of the highlights of my career.
The Delaney Cup now had a four-year resting place amongst the peoples of Holland.